The recipe that we used for our raviolis came from my mom. She passed it down to her six daughters. And I'm about the only one who's keeping on with it because the family's getting smaller. So. You take your ingredients, all your dry ingredients, put them in a large bowl, and then you start adding eggs, one egg per every cup of flour that you use. That's, and a teaspoon of salt for every four eggs. And if the dough seems a little dry, you can always add the fifth egg or a tablespoon of water. And you knead that by hand. You make a well in the flour and put your eggs in the well and beat them up and right in the flour, beat them up, and then you start pouring your flour over the eggs and start getting the dough into a ball, and then you take it out and you hand knead it until it gets very pliable.
Yeah, I when we made the well and put the eggs in there, I kind of took the fork and I kept pulling the flour into the well and mixing until everything, and we did have to add a little bit of water because it was a bit dry, and then we added water to bring it just to the moisture level that we liked.
We added more eggs because the original recipe was like an 8-cupper, but we're talking 4-cupper now. And 4 cups of flour, 4 eggs or 5 eggs, and a little water if it's too dry. And it takes a great deal of kneading, hand kneading, and that's one of the secrets of getting a pliable dough.
That was a big recipe. It was 8 cups, so it was a big ball, and we used semolina flour, which really made it a little bit heavier than like an all-purpose flour. So that took a little bit more work. You know, it was a heavier dough, a little stiffer. It took a lot more work to bring it into
shape. And don't you think the dry climate had a little bit of something of drying the dough out?
Yeah.
And you have to keep the dough covered at all times, under a bowl at all times. And when you start rolling it out, it should be covered with baking a cloth so that it doesn't dry out as fast. And you keep, if you can use the dough faster, like if you make 2 strips, you should make the ravioli. But
then roll out 2 more.
Roll
strips.
Out 2 more. But yeah. You know, in our family, we had a lot of help, so we would roll out 10 or 12 strips and cover them, and that's the way we work. But if you're working alone, it's a very hard process to do. When I make my pasta, I put a baking cloth on the table, and you fold it in half, and the front of where you're going to be working should be the open end. And I usually put my dough on the open end first, and then make 2 or 3 rows under the cloth. And then when you start making the ravioli, you use the ones from the front first. And that keeps the other ones covered and moist, but it's easier if you have help with you, you know. Yeah, and when people refer to dough as pasta dough or ravioli dough, it's the very same thing. It's the same recipe, you handle it the same way.
Yeah, so when ours started drying out, I don't know if we showed that, if we got that on film, we took the ones that were too dry to make into raviolis, and we just ran them through the pasta maker and cut them into linguine, and now we have linguine, fresh linguine, ready to eat. So
I can tell you that my wife and I make ravioli a lot at home, and everything my mother said, my wife does. So if it's, and as the dough does dry, we live in a very dry climate, she does in fact sprinkle the dough with that extra water, and then I get my muscle and I'm allowed to get my hands in there. We make a lot of them. It's very enjoyable, and that's part of my mom's recipe too.
Also, we cut them in with the scrap dough that's left over, if you have it. You roll it out to a thin, and you can cut it on the machine into like linguine strips. And then you can lay the linguine strips out and cut them this way and make pastina. Those little square pastinas.
And use them in chicken soup a lot.
Yeah.
That's a real typical noodle for a brothy kind of soup.
So actually you don't waste any of it at all. Yeah. When you get ready to make your ravioli filling, you take a very good grade of ground meat and put it in a frying pan that has a very slight oil to get the meat started. You do not fry the meat, you just
brown it.
Not even brown it, you just get the color out of it. And after you get the color out of it, you can put like 2 cups of sauce over it and kind of simmer it a little bit. The old fashioned way was making your spaghetti sauce with a lot of meatballs. And then you take out all the meatballs and you go through and smash all the meatballs into the meat. That was the original way we used to do it. But then as times change, you change to a faster way maybe, a little faster way.
That was my job when I was a kid, by the way, was to crush the meatballs for my grandmother. That was my job.
After the meat is cooled, you can add a little bit of garlic and a little bit of grated Parmesan or Romano cheese or Pecorino Romano. Like I'm saying, 2 or 3 tablespoons at the most to say 3 pounds of meat. Then the cheese can be any kind of a what we call ricotta cheese. This time we used sheep cheese, but you could use ricotta.
Yeah.
Italian.
Well, it was a ricotta style sheep cheese that a friend of ours made, and we added some egg. So we had fresh Swiss chard in the garden. So we cooked it up and really finely chopped it. Traditionally, you'd use spinach, but since we had fresh Swiss chard, we chopped it very fine. We mixed it in with the egg and the cheese, and a little bit of, I put a little Romano in there. I grated some Romano in there and fresh ground pepper.
Yeah.
I think that was everything.
That was everything.
Yeah, and then we mixed that together, and that was the cheese filling, and that was incredible.
When you're rolling out your dough in your pasta machine or by hand, the noodles should be about 5 inches at least in width. And probably your desire of the thickness, but usually the thinner you can do it, the better they taste. And you make 2 noodles for each form. So you put 1 noodle, but you have to take your form, you put flour on the bottom form, 1 layer of pasta, and there's the form comes in 2 parts. So the top part you put onto the noodle and press down, and it makes the indentations for the filling. And then you put any liquid, you could use milk, wine, water, in order to make the top layer of pasta stick to the bottom layer after it's filled. And then you put a little less than a teaspoon, depending on the size of your mold, or if you make them by hand, you could make them as large as you want and you could put more filling.
The way we do it, we make it, we make our dough, I would say, thin. However, we don't use a mold. We roll out machine, and we make our strips, and we just indiscriminately cut squares. And the raviolis that Nikki and I make are about
big.
2 or 2.5 inches square.
Yeah, they're big.
Whereas Mom's are
little.
Very conveniently made small.
Yeah.
So when I eat raviolis, I eat 4. Whereas when I eat at my mother's raviolis, I eat 14. So we don't use the mold. We just fill that 2 or 2.5 inch square generously with cheese or meat, and then just take another one and put it over the top. And my job is to wet the dough to create a seal. And then I just use a regular conventional fork. And I pinch the ravioli on both sides. And then we're ready to go.
But when you're using the molds that are shown in the film, there's about no more than a teaspoon. And then you put your first your wine, then your filling, and then the top layer goes on. And you layer it not stretched tight. You kind of ease it on so that there'll be a little bit of room for the air to, so that if you put them too flat, the air comes out. So you just have to use your rolling pin over the top mold and it'll cut them into size. And then you have to bang the mold on a breadboard or whatever you're using to start the ravioli coming out of, off the mold. So. And if you're overfill your ravioli, either with the meat or with the cheese, you'll have a lot of broken ravioli. So when you're making the ravioli with the machine, there's a dial on the machine, and you start out where the dough comes out the first time on the thick side, and you move your dial to the numbers to get them thinner. And some of the machines start with a low number, and some of them start with a high number. So you have to be very aware of the number on the machine. And we did ours on like a number 3 twice, and then we moved up to number 5 and did it to another couple times. If you're using a rolling pin, you just roll it to your desired thickness, which should not be thick at all. So when the raviolis are done and sealed, you could do a little cleanup, and then you have this large pan of rapidly boiling water before you drop the ravioli in. You can salt the water if you like. And if the pan will hold 4 dozen, they almost instantly rise to the top. And I know a lot of people say, oh, 3 to 5 minutes, they're done. The only way I do it is by taste testing. I do not time them in any way, any fashion. Just, I cook them until they're cooked. A lot of people like them al dente, a lot of people like them soft. So you taste test, that's the way I do it. When removing the ravioli, from the boiling water, you do not pour it out into a colander because they will break. You take them out with a slotted spoon and put them on your serving dish. And when you serve them, it's a really good idea to put a little layer of sauce in the dish first, and then the ravioli, and then a little sauce. And then you can always serve them at the table with available sauce.
And this is a very fun project to do as a group. It's a fun thing to do. We had a lot of people here. We made the raviolis. We ate most of them. I think we froze
some cheese ones.
Yeah, a couple of handfuls, because we just ate them all up. And it was once again, it's just fun. It's a labor intensive, but you know, raviolis, they don't grow on trees, as they say. And so we enjoyed it, and then we had a great dinner afterwards, and it was really a fun day and a fun evening.
If you make more than you really want to use at one time, you take a cookie sheet, put some kitchen paper, it's called, like wax paper, or really prefer parchment paper, and lay your raw ravioli on there and shove them in the freezer until they're definitely frozen to death. And then you can pour them in boxes or in a bag, and then you can pull out as many as you want, but they have to definitely be frozen before you throw them in the bag. Another important thing that you might want to know is don't rinse them after you take them out of the rolling hot water. Do not rinse the pasta. A lot of people rinse their pasta. You do not rinse the raviolis.
Yeah, that if you rinse it, the sauce doesn't stick to them.
Well, I was always taught if you rinsed the homemade pasta, you were rinsing away the Italian's sedative. Ravioli tends to put Italians to sleep, especially after a nice meal.
And a big glass of wine.
A big glass of wine.